everyone, assalamu alaikum. In this video, we are going to cover the process of erythropoiesis, that is the formation of red blood cell. How does it happen? Now, erythropoiesis is made up of two words. Erytho means RBCs and poiesis means formation. So, erythropoiesis means RBC formation. So, by definition, erythropoiesis is the process of origin, development and maturation of erythrocytes. What is it? It is the process of origin, development and maturation of erythrocytes. Now, erythropoiesis occurs at different sites during different phases of a life. We'll see how these sites vary during the fetal life, in newborn babies, adults and children. Okay. Now, in fetal life, erythropoiesis occurs in three different periods at three different sites. First is the mesoblastic stage, then we have the hepatic stage, and then we have the myeloid stage. The mesoblastic stage is during the first 2 to 3 months of intrauterine life, means during the pregnancy. Where the RBCs are produced? The RBCs are produced from the mesenchyme cells of the yolk sac here. Okay, in the mesoblastic stage, RBCs are produced from the mesenchymal cells of the yolk sac. Then we come to hepatic stage. Hepatic refers to liver. Okay, so in this, liver will be the main organ producing RBCs, and this is during the next 3 months, that is the second trimester of pregnancy. So in the second trimester of pregnancy, RBCs are produced mainly from the liver. Some cells are produced from the spleen also and some from the lymphoid organ also. So basically from three areas, the RBCs are being produced, the liver mainly and also some from the spleen and lymphoid organ. Then we have the myeloid stage, that is the third trimester, means the last 3 months of pregnancy. Here the child's RBC will be produced from the bone marrow and liver. At this stage, the process starts resembling the living human being to a great extent. Okay, so we learned that in fetal life, erythropoiesis occurs in different sites in different periods, mesoblastic, hepatic and myeloid. Now the process of erythropoiesis after birth is divided into two categories, up to 20 years of age and above 20 years of age. Now few of you might be below 20 years of age because you are just a BDS first year student, I guess. So in you guys, the RBCs are produced from the red bone marrow of all the bones. But for me, because I am much older than 20 years of age, I am in my 30s, my body has achieved maturity and the further growth has stopped in me. So RBCs in my case will be produced from all the membranous bones and ends of long bones, right? Moving on to the process of erythropoiesis, which is very important, we'll be discussing this process into two phases. First, we'll see how erythrocytes are formed from the stem cells in the hematopoietic system. And next, we will discuss the stages of development and maturity of the RBCs. Okay, so each type of blood cell, whether it is WBC, RBC, platelet, it begins as a hematopoietic stem cell. Now, hematopoietic stem cell means it is a cell which can convert into any of these cells. Now, these cells are called uncommitted pluripotent hematopoietic stem cell, PHSC. Why uncommitted? Because they don't know yet what kind of cell they're going to make. For example, let us suppose you are dating someone, you have a girlfriend or a boyfriend, you are in the initial stages of your life and your relationship, and you don't know whether you're going ahead with this relationship seriously in future. So you are now uncommitted. But once you are sure, like with whom you're going to marry or whatever, the same thing is here. Initially, the cells are uncommitted PHSC. But when these cells are designed to form a particular type of cell, the uncommitted PHSCs are now called the committed PHSC. There are two types of committed PHSC. One is the lymphoid stem cell and then colony-forming blastocytes. We have lymphoid stem cell. The second one is the colony-forming blastocyst. Lymphoid stem cells give rise to obviously lymphocytes and natural killer, that is the NK cells. Coming to colony-forming blastocysts, they give rise to all the other type of cells except the lymphocytes. They will differentiate to form different colony-forming unit, including the colony-forming unit for erythrocytes, which form RBC, granulocytes or monocytes that form different granulocytes, and megakaryocytes, which develop into platelets. Now we'll discuss the second part of our process, where erythrocytes develop from the colony-forming unit into mature erythrocytes. So here, four important changes occur in this process. First, There is reduction of the size of cell. They reduce from a diameter of 25 to 7.2 mu. Second is the disappearance of nucleoli in nucleus. Because we know that erythrocytes are non-nucleated, right? So the nucleus and nucleocytes has to disappear in the process of erythropoiesis. Then obviously we'll have appearance of hemoglobin, and then there will be change in the staining properties of cytoplasm. So let's discuss the stages of erythropoiesis one by one. The cell begins from pro-erythrocyte as the first stage and ends up becoming the mature erythrocyte. So first we have the pro-erythroblast. Okay, starting phase, pro-erythroblast. Then we have early normoblast, intermediate normoblast, late normoblast. Then we have reticulocyte, matured erythrocyte. So to remember this, remember that first we have pro-erythroblast, and then we have three normoblasts: early, intermediate, late normoblast. Then we have reticulocyte. Reticulum develops in reticulocyte, and then finally we have the matured erythrocyte. So let's discuss these steps. Pro-erythroblast is also known as megaloblast. Why megaloblast? Because they have a very large size. The cell diameter is 20 mu. It has a large nucleus with two or more nucleoli, and chromatin network is present here. Hemoglobin is absent. The cytoplasm is basophilic in nature. The pro-erythroblast multiplies several times and finally forms cells of the next stage called early normoblast. Now in early normoblast, the diameter decreases, like from 20 it goes to 15 mu. The nucleoli disappears from the nucleus, and condensation of chromatin network occurs. The condensed network becomes dense. The cytoplasm is basic in nature, so this cell is also called basophilic erythroblast. Okay, early normoblast is called basophilic erythroblast. This cell develops into the next stage called intermediate normoblast. Now, intermediate normoblast, the cells are even smaller. Like it was 15 mu, it came down to 10 to 12 mu now. The nucleus is still present, but the chromatin network shows further condensation. In this stage, we have the appearance of hemoglobin. It can be a viva question. Like, in which stage do you see hemoglobin formation? That is the intermediate normoblast stage. Now, because of the presence of small quantity of acidic hemoglobin, here we have acidic hemoglobin. The cytoplasm, which is basic in nature, becomes polychromatic, means both acidic and basic in nature. So this cell is called polychromatophilic or polychromatic erythroblast. Now this cell will develop into the next stage called the late normoblast. Now in late normoblast, the size decreases even further. It goes down to 8 to 10 mu. Okay? Nucleus becomes very small with a very condensed chromatin network. And it is called as ink spot nucleus. Viva question, where do you find ink spot nucleus? We find it in late normoblast. Quantity of hemoglobin increases, making the cytoplasm almost acidophilic. So the cell is now orthochromatic erythroblast, because now it is acidophilic. At the end of late normoblastic stage, just before it passes on to the next stage, the nucleus will disintegrate and disappear by the process called as pycnosis. What is pycnosis? It is the process by which nucleus disintegrates and disappears. The final remnant is extruded from the cell. The late normoblast develops into the next stage called reticulocyte. So in reticulocyte, it is larger than the matured RBC, because mature RBC is coming next. Now coming to reticulocyte, it is slightly larger than the mature RBC, but it is still smaller than the previous step, that is late normoblast. Okay? It is slightly larger than mature RBC. Basically, you can call it as immature RBC. It is called reticulocyte because reticular network or reticulum that is formed from the disintegrated organelles are present in the cytoplasm. The name is given because it has reticulum. What is reticulum? The organelles disintegrate and they're now present in the cytoplasm. Because of that disintegrated organelle, or reticulum, it is called as reticular network. The number of reticulocyte increases whenever the erythropoietic activity increases. Okay? Number of reticulocyte increases whenever the erythropoietic activity increases. Now, reticulocytes, they are produced. Okay? They enter the capillaries through the capillary membrane. And the method by which they do this is diapersis. Okay? Now coming to matured erythrocyte, the cell decreases in size. Now the diameter has reached to 7.2 mu. The reticular network disappears now and the cell becomes matured RBC. It has now biconcave shape and hemoglobin is present, but there is no nucleus. Okay, it requires 7 days for the proerythroblast to become fully developed and matured into RBC. Another viable question, how much time does it take for the proerythroblast to become a mature RBC? It takes just a week. So now we have our mature erythrocyte. Now this is a flowchart showing all the stages that we have just discussed. Please pause this video and have a look before proceeding. Next, we'll talk about the factors necessary for erythropoiesis. So there are various factors which can be classified basically into three categories. We have the stimulating factors, maturation factors, and the factors necessary for hemoglobin formation. Okay, so there are factors that stimulates, there are factors that helps in maturation, and there are factors which are necessary for hemoglobin formation. So we'll start with the stimulating factors. The first is hypoxia. Hypoxia means reduced availability of oxygen to the tissues. Okay, so when the tissues have lack of oxygen, it leads to erythropoiesis. How? Because there is secretion of erythropoietin from the kidney. The brain gives signals to the kidney that, you know, we have less amount of oxygen. So what the kidney does, it releases erythropoietin. Erythropoietin is a hormone. It releases that and this erythropoietin stimulates erythropoiesis. The second one, of course, is erythropoietin itself, which is a hormone. Mainly, it is secreted by peritubular capillaries in the kidney. Why the question? Remember that erythropoietin is secreted mainly by peritubular capillaries in the kidney. And small quantity is also secreted from the liver and the brain. So three places, remember. Mainly from where? Kidney, then liver, then brain. Hypoxia is a stimulant for secretion of erythropoietin as we just discussed. Okay. Whenever there is hypoxia, there will be secretion of erythropoietin. Coming to thyroxine, it is a general metabolic hormone. Thyroxine accelerates the process of erythropoiesis at many levels. Now, hematopoietic growth factors means they are the growth factors that causes the RBC production. These are interleukin 3, 6 and 11 and stem cell factor. Okay, generally these factors induce the proliferation of pHSCs. Okay, so the uncommitted ones, they proliferate so that they can form different types of cells. And lastly, we have the vitamins. Vitamin A, B, C, D, E are necessary for erythropoiesis. Deficiency of these vitamins causes anemia. Make sure you take your multivitamins if you're not having a healthy diet. Now, let's briefly discuss the role of erythropoietin before proceeding forward. Erythropoietin, what it does, it promotes the production of proerythroblast from the colony-forming unit erythrocytes of the bone marrow. It helps in the development of proerythroblast into mature RBCs through the several stages. It releases the mature erythrocytes into the blood, and some reticulocytes are also released along with the mature RBC. Next up, we have the maturation factors. Vitamin B12, intrinsic factor, and folic acid are necessary for the maturation of RBCs. Vitamin B12 is essential for the synthesis of DNA, cell division, and maturation of RBC. Vitamin B12 is stored mainly in the liver and in small quantities in the muscle. Its deficiency will cause pernicious anemia, that is macrocytic anemia, because the cell here are larger in size and they have a fragile and weak cell membrane. Okay? Then we have the intrinsic factor, which is produced in the gastric mucosa by the parietal cells of the gastric gland. Intrinsic factor is also essential for the absorption of vitamin B12 from the intestine. So when there is absence of intrinsic factor, it also leads to pernicious anemia because there is failure of vitamin B12 absorption. Now this deficiency of intrinsic factor occurs in conditions like severe gastritis, ulcer and gastrectomy. Let's talk about folic acid. Folic acid is also essential for the synthesis of DNA. When we have deficiency of folic acid, there is decrease in the DNA synthesis causing maturation failure. Here the cells are large and remain in the megaloblastic, that is the proerythroblastic stage, which leads to megaloblastic anemia. And lastly, we have the factors necessary for hemoglobin formation. So various materials are important here, such as the first class protein and amino acids of high biological value, okay? Iron is necessary for the formation of heme part of hemoglobin. Copper is essential for the absorption of iron from the GI tract. Cobalt and nickel for the utilization of iron during hemoglobin synthesis. Vitamin C, riboflavin, nicotinic acid, and pyroxidine for hemoglobin synthesis. So remember, absence of even a single factor from this list can impact the process of erythropoiesis. Let's summarize. In this video, we have discussed the process of production of erythrocytes or RBCs. We discussed how all the blood cells are formed by the same parent stem cell, the pluripotent hematopoietic stem cell. Next, we discussed the different stages of maturation of erythrocytes. And lastly, we have discussed the different factors controlling the rate of erythropoiesis. So I hope all these are now clear to you. The important questions from this topic include: discuss briefly the different stages of formation and maturation of erythrocytes. Important question. What is the role of erythropoietin in erythropoiesis? Enlist the different factors controlling the rate and process of the formation of erythrocyte. So continue revising these concepts with Dr. Teeth Notes. I'll see you in the next video. Take care. Allah Hafiz.